Let's have a look at different strategies for concurrency control. These are strategies employed by the database management system to ensure serializability of the transactions during runtime. So far, we have seen how to check whether a schedule is serializable. We've assumed that we know all the transactions and the actions. However, how do we ensure serializability during runtime? This is challenging because the system does not know in advance what transactions will run, what actions they perform, and what items they will access. So we need different strategies for ensuring serializability on the fly. There are pessimistic strategies, optimistic strategies, and there are multi-version techniques. The pessimistic strategies assume that conflicts are likely to happen, so we need to prevent them beforehand. In this course, we will discuss the log-based concurrency control. There is also a timestamp-based concurrency control, which is not discussed in this course. We will also discuss optimistic concurrency control strategies. They assume that conflicts are seldom, so they do not prevent them beforehand. For each transaction, they keep track of a read-write set. And then when the transaction tries to commit, they check whether there have been any conflicts and whether the transaction needs to be aborted. And if not, then the results are committed to the database. Finally, there are multi-version techniques, so they keep different snapshots of the database. So in principle, you can imagine this as follows, that when a transaction is run, then this database management system keeps a snapshot of the database at the time when the transaction has been started. And due to this snapshot, read-only queries basically never need to be aborted. You can assume conceptually that they run instantaneously at the time of the snapshot. So we need less concurrency control overhead for these queries. The main strategy of concurrency control in database management systems today is two-phase locking. The basic idea of log-based concurrency control is that transactions must log objects before accessing them. There's different types of logs. There are shared logs and there are exclusive logs. We denote shared logs short by S and exclusive logs short by X. A shared log needs to be acquired on an object before reading the object. And as the name shared suggests, many transactions can hold a shared log on the same object. An exclusive log needs to be acquired on an object before writing the object. And also, as the name exclusive suggests, only one transaction can hold an exclusive log on an object. And if this transaction holds an exclusive log, then no other transaction can hold any log on this object. So neither other exclusive logs on this object nor other shared logs on this object. An exclusive log is stronger than a shared log. So if a transaction has an exclusive log, it can write the object and it can also read the object. On this slide, you see an example of a schedule with explicit log and unlock actions. So in the schedule, we write S of A for obtaining a shared log on the object A. We write X of A to obtain an exclusive log on the object A. We write U of A to unlock the object A. Sometimes it's necessary to be more precise because we might have a transaction that holds a shared and an exclusive log on the same object. And maybe we want to unlock only the exclusive log, but not the shared log. Then we can write unlock shared log of A or UX of A for unlock the exclusive log of A. Usually it suffices to write simply U of A. So let's have a look at the schedule the transaction 2 obtains a shared lock on A, then reads A, so it's fine, it can read A because it holds a shared lock. Then transaction 1 obtains an exclusive lock on B, that's fine, no other transaction has any lock on B. Then it writes B, that's allowed because it holds an exclusive lock. Then it unlocks the exclusive lock on B. Now transaction 2 obtains an exclusive lock on B. That's also allowed because transaction 1 no longer holds any lock on B. It has unlocked B. Now transaction 2 can write B and it unlocks the lock on A and it unlocks the lock on B. Two-phase locking is the concurrency control protocol that is used in most database management systems today. It's a variant of lock-based concurrency control, so we have to obtain shared locks before reading objects, and we have to obtain exclusive locks before writing objects. But moreover, the two-phase locking requires that a transaction cannot obtain any new lock once it has released any lock. So therefore, we can imagine transactions to run in different phases, namely first a phase obtaining locks, then once we have released a lock, we cannot obtain any more locks, we can only release locks. So a transaction can be distinguished into a lock phase, obtaining the locks, and the phase of releasing the locks. And the nice thing about the two-phase locking is that every schedule that confirms to two-phase locking is conflict serializable. So two-phase locking ensures serializability of our schedules. Let's have a look at these examples and let's check for each of them whether they adhere to the two-phase locking protocol. You may want to pause the video in order to check for yourself. Okay, let's start with the first schedule. The schedule does not adhere to the two-phase locking protocol because in transaction 2 we have an unlock followed by a lock. The two-phase locking protocol forbids to obtain any lock after a transaction has unlocked a lock. So this schedule does not adhere to the two-phase locking protocol. Next, here in each transaction we have the unlocks only after the locks. So we obtain a shared lock, exclusive lock, and then we have the unlocking. So we have two-phase locking in principle. However, are the locks also obtained in the right way? In this transaction, in the second one, we obtain an exclusive lock on B. This is not released. And then the first transaction tries to obtain an exclusive lock on B. So this is not allowed with exclusive locks. If a transaction holds an exclusive lock on some object, no other transaction can hold any lock on this object. So these two locks are conflicting with each other. So the schedule also does not adhere to the two-phase locking protocol. In the third schedule, we again have a problem with the phases of the locking. Here we again have an unlock followed by a lock. So again, this does not adhere to the two-phase locking protocol. And the last schedule, we've already seen this schedule. We've already checked that the transactions obtain the right locks before reading and writing. So the transaction 2 obtains shared lock on A before reading A. Transaction 1 obtains an exclusive lock on B before writing B. Then unlocks B. So because B is unlocked, now the second transaction can obtain an exclusive lock on B. Now the second transaction unlocks A, and this is allowed because after unlocking, no further locks are obtained by transaction 2. We can write B because we still have the exclusive lock on B, and then we can unlock B. So this schedule performs in the correct phases, in each transaction first obtaining locks, then releasing locks. Also, the locks do not conflict, And before reading every object, we obtain the shared log. Before writing an object, we obtain the corresponding exclusive log. So this schedule is correct with respect to the two-phase locking protocol. Let's revisit the example of the concurrent ATM transaction that we've seen before. So here we have two ATM transactions that are occurring at the same time. I'm withdrawing 100 euros and my wife is withdrawing 200 euros at the same time at two different ATMs, and we're withdrawing from the same bank account. The transaction, as it is written here, does not adhere to the two-phase locking protocol, because the transaction tries to acquire a new lock after already having unlocked a lock. So this transaction, as depicted here, does not adhere to the two-phase locking protocol. So now let's make a transaction that adheres to the two-phase locking protocol, and let's see how this prevents this anomaly. So in order to comply with the two-phase locking protocol, the ATM transaction must not acquire any new lock after having released the lock. So one way to make the ATM transaction compliant with two-phase locking is as follows. We immediately acquire an exclusive lock on the bank account. Then we read the balance. We change the local variable, the balance. And then we write the updated balance back on the bank account. And afterwards, we release the lock. We could also do it slightly differently. I mean, we want to read the value on the bank account and we want to write it. So it's sufficient to obtain an exclusive lock and hold it from the start to the end. In principle, we could also do it different. We could first obtain a shared lock. This suffices for reading. And then when we want to write, we could upgrade the shared lock to an exclusive lock by additionally requesting an exclusive lock. Then we can write, and afterwards we can unlock the shared and the exclusive lock. So now let's see what happens if our concurrent ATM transactions adhere to the two-phase locking protocol. So we're using the transaction shown on the last slide. We are first obtaining an exclusive lock on the account, then we are reading it, we are doing some computation, we are writing the account, and then we are unlocking the account. Now, the concurrent transaction 2 also tries to obtain an exclusive lock. And only one transaction can hold an exclusive lock on an object at a time. No other locks are allowed then. So since transaction 1 already holds an exclusive lock on the account, the attempt of transaction 2 to obtain an exclusive lock will be blocked. So this transaction will have to wait until the account has been unlocked by the first transaction. And only after it has been unlocked, then the exclusive lock for transaction 2 will be granted. Transaction 2 can read the account, write the account, and unlock the account. So since this exclusive lock is blocked until transaction 1 unlocks the account, transaction 2 actually reads the correct value after the account has been updated by transaction 1. So transaction 1 updated the account to 1100, transaction 2 will read the correct value 1100 and will do the correct computation, subtracting 200 euros, and update the account with the right value 900. So by the two-phase locking protocol, the attempt to obtain the exclusive lock is blocked until no other transaction holds a lock on this object. And thereby, both transactions are now executed correctly. Let's practice a bit two-phase locking in the online system. In this task, we are asked to show that this schedule can be achieved using the two-phase locking protocol by inserting the correct lock and unlock actions. Let's have a look. So we read A, we definitely need a shared lock on A. We write B, we need an exclusive lock on B. This exclusive lock also serves for reading B, so we don't need a shared lock here. Here we need an exclusive lock on B. Now we already see that we have a conflict between these locks on B. So this transaction 2 must release the lock on B. So we say we unlock B. Okay, now B is unlocked. Now the first transaction is allowed to lock B. Here we need an exclusive lock on A. But if we insert before exclusive lock on A, then our schedule does not adhere to the two-phase locking protocol. Because after unlocking a lock, we are now not allowed to obtain any new lock. So this is not allowed. We have to do this differently. We have to get this lock on A earlier. So for instance, instead of the shared lock, we can immediately get an exclusive lock on A. I will delete this shared lock and I will immediately ask for an exclusive lock. This is not strictly speaking necessary. We could also have first gotten the shared lock and later upgraded it to an exclusive lock. But in this case, it's fine to immediately ask for an exclusive lock because no other transaction wants to read A during this time. Okay. Now we have our lock on A that allows us to write A. Let's see how it goes on. Here we need a shared lock on C. Oh, I did this wrong. I should insert it before shared lock on C. Here we need a shared lock on B. Okay, here we will need an exclusive lock on C. Now let's have a look. Okay, this shared lock on B does not conflict with this shared lock on C. It, however, we have a problem because here is an exclusive lock on B. So we have to release this exclusive lock on B before we get the shared lock. So let's at this point say that we want to add an unlock before. Let's say we want to unlock B. Okay, now we unlock B. Now we are allowed to get the shared lock here. Okay, that's fine. Now, this shared lock on C is no longer fine because we violate the two-phase locking protocol. We are not allowed to obtain a new lock after we've unlocked. So we have to delete this. And we have to get this lock on C earlier, namely before unlocking, we get a shared lock on C. Okay, now we are allowed to read C here. We are allowed to read B here. And the shared lock on C conflicts with this exclusive lock on C. So we have to unlock directly after reading C. We unlock the shared lock on C. Okay, now let's have a look. The lock on B is unlocked. The lock on A still is valid. So let's unlock A after we don't need it anymore. We unlock the exclusive lock on A. Okay, now we have an exclusive lock on B. This is unlocked here. That's fine. We get a shared lock on C. That's unlocked here. That's fine. Shared lock on B is not yet unlocked and the exclusive lock on C is not yet unlocked. Okay. Then let's just, after we read C, unlock both the shared lock on B and the exclusive lock on C. So we unlock the exclusive lock on C. And we also unlock the shared lock on B. Okay, good. As far as I can see, we now have a schedule that indeed adheres to the two-phase locking protocol. Let's check whether this is really true. Yes. Our schedule adheres to the two-phase locking protocol. We have a correct solution. And again, if you want to continue practicing, feel free to do so. Simply say that you want a new task and you can solve a new puzzle. Have fun.